Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Warm welcome to you on this lovely morning. We pray you bless us. And if you're visiting with us, you're very welcome as well. So we pray the Lord will bless each one as we come to worship him. And kind of welcome everyone who watches this service online. We pray the Lord will bless you as you watch recordings of this service. So a warm welcome to you. Now we have some, we have actually quite a few announcements, so I hope you'll bear with me for a little moment. You'll find in the pews our appeal envelopes, our reminder of the appeal for the Presbyterian Children's Society. You should have a leaflet in your pew that will allow you to find out information about that. And we're asking you to return your donation envelope by Sunday the 19th. Of June. So if you have any questions, please see Billy, but it would be grateful if you could return that envelope by the 19th of June. I have received some commemorative John's Gospels. There are a few of them available in the vestibule on your way out. Please feel free to take them, they are free, and you're very welcome to lift one and pass it on if you wish, or hold on to it yourself. The midweek Bible study and prayer time will continue on Wednesday at 7:30 here, and you're very welcome to come as we study the Bible and worship together. With regards to some future events, Carrick Parish Church is having a wedding dress festival on Friday the 10th of June and Saturday the 11th of June. On Friday it's between 6 and 9, and on Saturday between 10 and 6 p.m. That's 10 o'clock in the morning, so that's a wedding dress festival if you're interested in heading along to that. Next week, weekend also, the Faith Mission are holding their Roe Valley Bible Weekend, and that will be up at Largy Community Hall. There'll be singers and speakers each evening, Friday, Saturday and Sunday. Friday and Saturday will be at 8 p.m. and Sunday will be 8:15, so that's between the 10th and the 12th of June. I think there's only one other announcement, and that is that it is with regret we want to express our sympathy to Molly Hamilton following the death of her brother, who passed away this weekend. And we want to express our sympathy. I believe he was buried this week. Molly Hamilton's brother Eddie passed away, and we want to extend our sympathy to him today, to that family circle. Those are all of our announcements. We read in Psalm 21 these words: O Lord, the king rejoices in your strength. How great is his joy in the victories you give. You have granted him the desire of his heart and have not withheld the request of his lips. You welcomed him with rich blessings and placed a crown of pure gold on his head. He asked you for life and you give it to him, length of days forever and ever. Through the victories you gave, his glory is great. You have bestowed on him splendor and majesty. Surely you have granted him eternal blessings and made him glad with the joy of his presence. For the king trusts in the Lord. Through the unfailing love of the Most High, he will not be shaken. Be exalted, O Lord, in your strength. We will sing and praise your might. Even kings worship the Lord God Almighty. And we sing glory to him now as we stand together and sing, to God be the glory. Let's worship him today.
Glory to God.
prayer, let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are Lord and God of all. We worship you on this beautiful Sunday morning, thanking you that we are able to come before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You are the one, Father, to whom we are to turn in worship and reverence. Whether we feel that we are the lowliest in the land or at the height of thrones, we come to rejoice and to praise your name. Our Heavenly Father, throughout your word, you tell us that kingdoms rise and fall at your word, in your will. But we are reminded that your kingdom is eternal and lasts forever. We thank you, our Father, that the picture of kings in the Old Testament is fulfilled totally in King Jesus. The idea of a kingdom coming along that is finite is fulfilled with a kingdom that is everlasting and whose will and precepts is done. Our Father, we honor your name. We praise you this day. We thank you, our Father, that there is no shadow of turning in you. We thank you, our Father, that there's no lack of strength after all these years of your faithfulness to your people. We thank you, our Father, that your promises still stand. We thank you, our Father, that even though technology changes and people are able to do far more now than they used to, our greatest need of a Saviour is still met in Jesus Christ. And our Father, our greatest need is to know you, to have our sins forgiven, and to be able to serve you in gratitude for all that you've done for us. Father, we pray that you'd bless us this morning. We pray that you would forgive us our sin. And we pray that we would be overjoyed as we worship the true God of heaven, the Lord of all. Bless us in our time together, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Our Bible reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're going to read from verse 14 to verse 22. You'll find it on page 1151 of the Bible in the pew, page 1151. While you're looking that up, let me also say, I forgot to mention at the beginning, there's a cup of tea after the service, and there are some, what do you call those small things? The wee cupcakes, thank you. It's these technical phrases that get me. Cupcakes afterwards as well. We haven't had a cup of tea for 2 years. I'm ready for one. But you're very welcome to stay today. I hope that you will, and we'll spend some time over in the hall having fellowship with one another and catching up. We read from God's word from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 14. Therefore, my dear friends, flee from idolatry. I speak to sensible people. Judge for yourselves what I say. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one loaf. Consider the people of Israel. Do not those who eat the sacrifices participate in the altar? Do I mean then that a sacrifice offered to an idol is anything, or that an idol is anything? No. But the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God, and I do not want you to be participants with demons. You cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons too. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. Are we trying to arouse the Lord's jealousy? Are we stronger than he? May the Lord bless to us this reading of his own word today. Well, boys and girls, we're going to have a little chat with you and want to see what we can find in our children's talk today. Let me say that after I finish this little talk, there will be standing to praise, and then we're going to let you stay in to hear the music group, and they'll be singing a special piece, and then you can head out to Sunday school. So we're just going to keep you for one little moment further. So we want to have a little think about the idea of what we read in 1 Timothy chapter 6. And we read these words about the Lord being God of all and Lord of lords. And it's always good to have your talk ready. What we'll do is we'll read from 1 Timothy 6 together. God, the blessed, the only ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in unapproachable light, whom no one has seen or can see, to him be honour and might forever. Amen. I want us to think about the Queen's Jubilee today for a little moment. You may have heard about it. There's quite a few people talking about it, and there's been all sorts of parties and all sorts of things happening on in these days. And it's really quite a thing to be on a throne or in any kind of position for 70 years. I want you to think for a moment. I wonder why she's called Queen Elizabeth II. I wonder why that is. Why is she called Queen Elizabeth II? Does any boys and girls want to call out why they think that is? Because. I heard a because. I didn't get anything else. Yes?
Because she's the second.
She's the second Elizabeth is absolutely right. You know there was a first Elizabeth. Does anybody remember her? No? We might have to ask Dorothy Cunningham. She'd maybe remember. But Elizabeth I was the first Elizabeth. And the thing about kingdoms is, kings last for a certain time, queens last for a certain time, and then there's a new king comes. And that's why we talk about the heir to the throne. So even though some kingdoms have a king or queen that lasts a very short time, or a very long time, eventually they all come to an end. Those kingdoms come to an end. And whenever you get to big school and you do a history, you'll have to learn about a king, and you'll have to learn about how long they were on the throne for, and there's a lot of dates and everything to remember, because kingdoms, whether they're short or long, eventually come to an end. Reigns are sometimes very long, and Queen Elizabeth II has been on the throne, and maybe like me, you only ever remember her. That's amazing, isn't it? For your whole life, Queen Elizabeth has been on the throne. But kingdoms come and go, even if they've been there a long time. And as you read back through the Bible, one of the things you'll find is that there's lots of kings and rulers mentioned who were there for a little while and then they headed off again. There was pharaohs, different kings in Egypt, and they were about as well. And then you read about Roman emperors and Roman governors, and they were in place at a certain time. And then there was King Sennacherib. Anybody here called Sennacherib? No? There's all sorts of kings that come and go. There are high priests who would give advice to kings, and they would come and go. And then there was the Israelite kings. And then the different queens that are mentioned in the Bible too. Some of them good, some of them bad, all sorts of things as you look along through. I'm jealous of this boy's beard. I think I would suit something like that comes down to a point. It would be good, wouldn't it? That was Cyrus the Great. But no matter how long somebody's on the throne, eventually their kingdom comes to an end and the kingdoms change. One of the things that's mentioned about the Queen who's been on the throne for 70 years is that she has had a lot of different prime ministers. That's advisors. Those are the prime ministers who do the government's work and set the plans out and everything else. And she has to meet prime ministers once a week. and they discuss different things, and the prime ministers are there to advise about what's happening and so on. Maybe you can mention, maybe you can guess some of these prime ministers. There's a clue in the black and white one. He was the first one that she had. Who was? Who? What, Churchill? Thank you very much. There's a free cup of tea in the hall afterwards for you. So the kingdom's, the queen is there, and the advisors come along and they give her advice. Maybe you can see some of these different prime ministers. You'll remember them from your age as a person interested in politics, or maybe you have to go back a bit further and remember some of them, Labour and Conservative MPs and so on. But the Queen has been on the throne 70 years, and during that time she's had 14 UK prime ministers. There's been 14 US presidents. She's only met 13 of the 14. And you also get a cup of tea if you know the one that she didn't meet. Any idea which president she didn't meet? Answers on a postcard, please. And there's 170 people who have served in office as prime ministers or whatever over those 70 years through the different Commonwealth countries. So kingdoms rise and fall. Advisors come and go, and fashions change, don't they? Maybe some of you remember these kinds of fashions where you had the big block shoes, and if you went outside in them, you really needed a parachute on your back in case you fell off. But things that you look back on, do you remember the big wide lapels kind of come out to the side? You thought yourself you looked really cool, and now you look back and you think, what was I doing? I'm not sure. So the thing is that Queen Elizabeth has seen a lot of changes, hasn't she? 70 years. She has seen other kingdoms come and go. She has seen her advisors change. And she has seen fashions change. And yet she professes to say that throughout those 70 years, she has had her faith in one who doesn't change and whose kingdom doesn't end. And I liked it. It was on a quote on the Facebook that was on our website. And she said this back in 2000. For me, the teachings of Christ and my own personal accountability before God provide a framework in which I try to lead my life. I have drawn great comfort in difficult times from Christ's words and example. Isn't that interesting for a sovereign of a country to say about our own personal accountability before God? The monarch of the UK has a faith in the sovereign of the universe, a faith and strength that enables her to carry out her job is her testimony. And not only is that necessary and true for someone who's on the throne, but it's necessary for you and me to put our trust in the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And the Bible is very clear in what the message is. Jesus is the one who is the King of Kings. It's through this King that we can be saved by putting our faith in him. And then we follow him in thankfulness for all that he has done. Let's go back, boys and girls, to the verse that we had at the beginning. God, the blessed and only ruler, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who alone is immortal and who lives in inapproachable light, whom no one can see, has seen or can see, to him be honor and might forever. Immortal, forever. Those kind of words tell us that God's kingdom is eternal. Those kind of words tell us that his advice to us, his word to us, is timeless, doesn't change. And finally, it's a word about a Saviour that never goes out of fashion. Because our needs never change. We need a Saviour. Whatever generation we're from, we need to put our trust in him. May we do that through all the days of our lives and through the different changes that we see. We're going to sing a piece called Rainbow, and then we'll ask the boys and girls to sit again, and we'll have a music. musical piece called Rise Up and Serve.
Thank you.
Well, we're going to come to God in a prayer. Let us pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you today and we present to you, our gracious God and King, our offerings. We pray that you take and use these offerings to your glory and for the extension of your kingdom in these days. We thank you for the boys and girls in our midst and for those who teach them. We pray that you be with them today as they prepare for their children and young people's day. We pray that you'd watch over them and bless them. We thank you, our Father, that we do not come to church and divide up into age groups or social standing or whatever, but we come along and we come as a family to worship you, to be able to come together and know that your word speaks to us whatever age we are, and the privilege of knowing that whatever age we are, we can put our trust in Jesus and know salvation and know a God who will bless us and watch us over our days and into eternity. Today, our Father, we come before you and we acknowledge that we are incomplete and that we will lack peace in this world without you. We pray, Lord, that you would satisfy our souls, whether we feel we're going through a time of barren desert or a time of harvest where we are mightily blessed. We pray, our Father, that you would meet us where we are and enable us to know your blessing upon us, to see us through difficult days and to remind us to be thankful in days of blessing. We meet here, Father, with different emotions. Some of us will meet with broken hearts. Some of us will meet with gladness that we have come through difficult times. Some of us may come with a bit of foreboding, wondering what the future holds. And yet, Father, your promise to see your people through all generations, in your will, through all their days. And so we do thank you, Father, for the assurance that you'll forgive us, that you'll heal us, that you'll grant us your peace. And we pray indeed that this morning as we continue to worship, that we would be filled with a love that doesn't run dry, but that does satisfy our very souls. Over this weekend, Father, we have heard much about the Jubilee. We thank you for the testimony of Queen Elizabeth acknowledging you as her God and sustaining her over those many years. We thank you that as she has sought to serve the interests of her people, that you have been her stay. We thank you, Father, that even the highest in the land, the Queen, as she plays a role as a leader or as a servant at home and overseas and the head of the Commonwealth, through different advisors and everything else, still says that she knows her Saviour and that she is accountable to God. We pray, Lord, that this would be a message that would not get lost in all of the partying that takes place. We thank you, too, for her example in holding out the hand of peace in our own peace process here and in the Republic of Ireland. We thank you, Father, for that bravery and being able to break down barriers. And Father, we thank you that her trust is in the one who can break down the biggest barrier between ourselves and you, our Father. As she has sought to be a servant of Christ, Father, we pray that we would do also. Whether we are fans of the monarchy or not, we recognize that there is a King of Kings and a Lord of Lords. And so, our Father, today we pray that each one of us would have a respect for human life, for our own life and for the life of others around us. We pray, our Father, that we would never do anything that we would be ashamed of to be publicly owned. We pray, Lord, that we would never stoop to be mean and low to others. We pray, Lord, that we would never do anything in the present or the future that would cause regret, but rather build others up and glorify your name and live in a manner where our consciences are clear. And Father, we pray that you would, in these days, enable us to love others, whatever their political persuasion, whatever their social standing, whatever their bank balance. We pray that we would see the value that you place on human life. We pray, Lord, that we would be willing to help. Indeed, Father, we pray that we would be willing to help even before we're asked, because we're mindful of others around us. We pray, Father, that we would be people who would not injure or hurt, but rather build up and seek to help those in need. And through all of these things, Father, whether we're in private or whether we're in public, we pray that we would show reverence for you. We pray, Lord, that we would remember your word wherever we are. We pray, Lord, that we would remember your commands. And we pray that we would do nothing to grieve you, but rather to live in a manner whereby we can honor your name and glorify you before others. Our Father, we pray for Molly Hamilton following the death of her brother Eddie Cochran, or Crockett. We pray, Lord, that you would bless her and that whole family circle. We pray that you'd watch over them today and do them good. And for others who mourn or who are in pain, we pray that you'd bless them. We pray for those who watch this service online, we pray that you'd bless them, that you'd speak to their hearts and lives and warm their heart today with a knowledge of your presence. Father, we thank you for the time that we have shared together here and for the peace in which we meet. We realize that in other parts of the world, there are severe problems for Christians. We think of Nigeria, we think of other places where Christians have been killed in recent days. Father, be with those who mourn. Strengthen those who are afraid. And enable each one of us to honor you and witness for Jesus where you've placed us. Hear our prayer this day. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. We sing together, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. I want you to imagine that you're very ill. There appears to be nothing more that can be done. But you're offered a place on a clinical trial. It may be of some benefit to somebody else at some stage. During that trial, some will get the actual test drug and others will get a placebo. A placebo is an inactive substance that's administered in the course of drug trials so that the effectiveness of the actual drug can be measured. So you go through the process of the clinical trial, and then the trial concludes, and it's announced that the drug on trial is 100% effective with no negative side effects. It turns out that you had been given the placebo, and now you're eligible for the real McCoy, the real drug. Can you ever imagine replying to the offer of a real cure? No thanks. I'll just continue taking the one that doesn't work. Sounds a bit daft, doesn't it? I'll just continue to take the one that doesn't work. Whenever it comes to considering choosing the true God, why would you ever want to choose a fake, or the unreal, or the man-made, or the one that doesn't work? If you have turned to the God of heaven in faith, then why would you ever want to return to that which doesn't exist or doesn't work? Why would you ever follow an idol whenever you have the opportunity of the real living God? Why turn to that which offends God and angers him, the God that you say you've put your trust in? If there is a real God, as revealed by Jesus Christ, then why would you ever think of anything else? Maybe not so much now, but probably still there. I remember many years ago during Lost and so on, there would have been a lot of young Christians wearing a bracelet that had WWJD on it. What would Jesus do? And the idea was to encourage them to have something visible on their wrist that would remind them before they speak or act that what they say would have implications in terms of their witness. What would Jesus do before I speak or say anything? If you want to conscientiously follow the Lord in his footsteps, in his way, then what would he do in this situation? What would he say? And it's a very good idea to have that kind of thing, provided you remember that sometimes you yourself are more likely to choose the easier way or the way that suits yourself. If we're going to go down a line of what would Jesus do, we need to make sure that we're bringing it back to the touchstone of Scripture so that we don't fool ourselves into giving ourselves an easy out. There's a God in heaven who is absolutely real. There's only one we are to turn to, and that's through Jesus. And that's the reminder that we have here about considering the true God in verses 14 to 22. We've been looking through different questions that the Corinthians have sent to Paul, and he's coming towards the end of this as we head towards chapter 11. It starts off in chapter 8, now concerning food offered to idols. What should you be involved in as a Christian? What should you be involved in as a Christian? What should your attitude be for yourself and for others? We may not be running off to pagan temples, but the principles there. And so three things this morning we want to take a look at. The first, in verses 14 to 15, is flee from idolatry. Flee from idolatry. Flee from what is false. This is all going to be brought together next week, God willing, as we move towards the end of chapter 10. where we see that we're to do everything to the glory of God, and we're to do everything in his name for the benefit of others. We are to be people who live out a real relationship with the living, real God. There has been questions raised about what you can do in society, what you can be involved in. This is a town, a city called Corinth. Lots of pagan activity taking place. Lots of food, even in the butchers at some stage, had been offered to idols. What should a Christian do with that? And what Paul really says is this. It's one thing to go into a pagan temple and to participate in a pagan cemetery, a pagan ceremony. It's something different to go into a butcher's and buy food that now has no meaning or no attachment to idols or anything else. But make sure that as you go through all of these events in your life, that you are someone who flees from idolatry. Don't mess with it. Make sure that if you're a follower of the living God, you don't get sucked into thinking you can do anything because God will forgive you. Don't get sucked into saying, I can do anything and I'll be strong enough to resist all of the temptations. It is true that at the end of verse 13, we're told that God will give us a way of escape. But it's clear Paul isn't sure that his readers can be trusted to take that way. No, what you need to do, my dear friends, he says, is flee from idolatry. This word flee has the idea of speed in it. It's got the idea of determination. It's got the idea of putting distance between you and something else. Flee from what is going on that would lead you away from God. Flee from anything that would make sure that you were annoying and angering God. If you don't, you can get consumed with all of this. The idolatry that was around the Corinthians was extraordinarily pervasive. And one commentator says, what Paul is saying is this, there is to be no leisurely contemplation of sin, thinking that one can go so far and be safe from going further. The only wise course is to have nothing to do with it. Sometimes you'll see people playing with fire, and they'll see how close they can get to the fire. And then all of a sudden they go too close. Ow! They get caught. And it's the same with messing about with things that do not point us to God. In fact, it's something that can burn us very quickly. And Paul is worried about these Corinthians, that they might not be able to shake off their pagan past, their old way of life before they became Christians. And so he says in verse 14, flee from idolatry. Put distance between it. Do it quickly. Do it with determination. The Corinthians should be people who have fled from their past and cling to Christ. And it's interesting here that Paul doesn't take the approach of boxing people around the ears. What he does is he appeals to them in verse 17 as sensible people. It would be lovely to be included in that group, wouldn't it? To be included with the sensible people. And he says to you, I want you to think through this. I'm not here to beat you into shape. I'm appealing to you as my dear brothers. Look at your behavior. Are you honoring Christ? Are you showing that you are his child? Are you living in a way that naturally shows that you belong to the children of light? That you're living in the kingdom of Jesus. And so he tells them, flee from idolatry. Don't mess about with anything that's from the past that would lead you away from God. Flee from idolatry. Verses 16 to 18, we see the principle that he wants us to hold on to, and that is that fellowship is participation. Fellowship is participation. That's what he outlines in verse 16. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Sometimes people will talk about the Lord's Supper being an act of remembrance. And that's a part of what it is. But it's not the only part, because we're actually sharing communion with God. If a meal is just a remembrance, then it doesn't have much meaning. But the actual fact is that whenever we share in the Lord's Supper, we have communion with God. We're coming into His presence. We're participating spiritually in the life and sacrifice of Jesus. We are coming to remember His body broken and all the punishment laid on His body. We're coming to remember His blood shed to wash away all our sins. And that idea of coming together and having participation in that is about fellowship. It's about communion. It's about holding together the same values and experience and concerns together. It's not a meaningless act. It's not an empty expression, but rather it's our faith professing that we are putting our trust in the atoning sacrifice of Jesus for all the forgiveness of our sins. And although the bread and the wine remain unchanged, the partakers are changed. They're identifying their involvement in the death of Christ by faith. And so then we are nourished and strengthened and comforted. Our souls are enriched. We are assured of the forgiveness of God. This is something in which we participate, not a mere memorial. Now, if you are a Christian and your profession is that you are participating in Christ at communion, then how on earth can you yourself then go and participate in something that belittles Jesus, that doesn't acknowledge who He is, that has an active participation in something that doesn't exist? How can you attend, in our case maybe today, Eastern religious classes looking for insight whenever you want to participate in the blood of Jesus? How can you go to horoscopes or tarot cards for readings whenever you have put your trust in the one who is eternal? If we follow Christ, we must leave everything that is pagan behind. And the fellowship that we have with God doesn't end there, because not only at communion do we have fellowship with the God of heaven, but we have fellowship horizontally with one another. You may have an individual cup, you may have an individual piece of bread, but the fellowship that we share is as one body, one family, united through faith in Christ. Whenever we come to communion together, we are participating together. It is a love that we share, and the thing that unites us as we come together from diverse backgrounds is personal faith in Jesus. And whenever we come, we express that oneness in Christ's body through a personal union with Him. Fellowship is horizontal and it's vertical, and we participate in the sacrifice of Jesus by faith, and that is something that is also there as we come for communion. And just to show it's not a new idea, we see that idea outlined in verse 18, where we go back to the same principle in the Old Testament, where people, whenever they took part in the sacrificial system of the Old Testament, were sharing fellowship together. And they knew that as they came to the altar and were participants in the sacrifices, they were entering into fellowship with God. They were running the flag up the pole to say, this is where I belong. This is who I'm putting my trust in. And so it's the same for you and me. Flee from idols. Put distance at speed with determination between you and the old that was without God. recognize the principle that fellowship is participation. As you come to the Lord's Supper, you are participating in the death and sacrifice of Jesus for your sins, acknowledging all that he has done for you. And then the warning comes in verses 19 to 22. False idols, yes, but real demons. False idols, but real demons. I see Paul here really walking a bit of a balance, because on one hand he wants to say that idols are nothing and food offered to idols are nothing, but he also wants us to see that there's something behind it lurking that's much more sinister. Yes, idols can be just stone, man-made items, planets, something around creation, empty and meaningless. But behind it, there are demons wanting to pull people away from God, wanting to snare them and destroy them. So while idols are nothing, pagans will be worshipping something that doesn't exist. The truth is that demons are there to take people away from God and to tempt them away from God. And that's what you see in verses 19 to 20. Sacrifice offered to idols, verse 19, is it anything? No. But, verse 20, the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. And I do not want you to be participants with demons. There's a principle here, isn't there? The principle is that participation in eating and drinking at communion aligns you with Christ. That same principle applies if you go into a pagan banquet. If you go to an idol shrine, it's not a neutral activity. They constitute fellowship with demons, and therefore the believer is at risk of angering God. Idols are nothing, but the occult's real. Kingdom of darkness, kingdom of light. Idols are nothing, wood, stone, but demons will want to use people's susceptibility to be their own boss, to be their own God, to take you away from the God of heaven to whom you should be clinging. You and I today may not just be as aware of the occult dimensions that are out there, but if you go to other countries, other places in the world, for Christians, it's a very real thing today. And just because we have a veneer of acceptability and goodness over our society, that doesn't say there's not other things underneath. No, be careful what you join yourself to. Be careful what football shirt you put on to say what team you're on. Those who worship idols have fellowship with demons. Therefore, there's no place at that table for anybody who has fellowship with God. To the Corinthians, be careful about who you're aligning yourself to. Make sure that if you're the people of God, bought with the blood of Jesus, then live for him and participate only in what Jesus says is right. And verse 21 then highlights that issue of angering the God of heaven, who we want to be close to. Don't drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You can't serve two masters. The believers in Corinth proclaimed their superior knowledge, thought they could do anything at all, and it wouldn't have any impact on them. And Paul says, no, that's an impossibility. Don't provoke the Lord to jealousy. Don't disappoint the one you claim to be yours. Well, we don't have many pagan temples around Loma Valley. We don't have this kind of possibility of eating food offered to idols, it seems. But we get the principle, though, don't we? The principle is that if we're going to do all to the glory of God, we should only be involved in things that bring glory to God. There is no place for us to have any link with anything that is demonic. And so Ouija boards are not good. I remember listening to people who were into spiritism who also said that they wouldn't go down the line of Ouija boards because it was too dangerous. Tarot cards, occult practices, fortune telling, seances, witchcraft, all of these things are not to be part of the Christian's existence and experience. Rather, we are to be a people who are clinging to Christ and going with him. Don't give Satan a foothold in your life. If you claim to be a Christian, don't go looking for the answer in things around you that are there to quench your appetite. Rather, look for the love of God and what glorifies God. And don't compromise on putting Jesus first and following him. There is only one kingdom that will last forever. There is only one word that never goes out of fashion. There is only one who can meet our greatest need. And that is the wonderful, merciful Saviour. And we're going to praise him now, as we come to the end of our service. Wonderful, merciful Saviour, let us stand and worship God.
Save your soul.
to have you there. We'll say our grace as well. The Bible tells us to pray for those over us, and we're going to close after the benediction with the national anthem, which I trust we will sing as a prayer. God save our gracious Queen as we complete our service together. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to have fellowship and refreshment together. We pray that you'd enable us to be a thankful people as we are able to share together the goodness of your provision for us. We pray that you'd bless our time together. And we pray, Father, that we would remember that there is one God in heaven, one eternal kingdom, one Saviour, and it is by faith in the free offer of the gospel that we find ourselves as children of God in that kingdom. May that be something that warms our hearts and draws us to you. And we pray that we would know in the days ahead the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore.